I'm Linda Hirsch, and this is EdCast, a program created and produced by educators for everyone interested in education. From its beginnings in 2012, CUNY's Gutman Community College was heralded as an innovation in community college education and as a way to improve on the poor graduation rates of these schools. Now, almost a decade later, one of its founding faculty and an education policy expert takes a look at the complexities of this undertaking and why it may not have lived up to its great expectations. What can we learn from the development of this community college and its efforts at reform? Today, educator Chet Jordan joins me to tell the story of Gutman Community College and to discuss his book, Establishing an Experimental College in the United States, coming up now on EdCast. Joining me today is Chet Jordan, higher education administrator and scholar. In 2012, he joined the founding faculty at Gutman Community College, building from the ground up an experimental associate's degree granting institution. Dr. Jordan is the co-author of two books, CUNY's First 50 Years, Triumphs and Ordeals of a People's University, and Post-Recession Community College Reform, A Decade of Experimentation. His most recent book, Establishing an Experimental Community College in the United States, Challenges, Successes, and Implications for Higher Education, narrates the planning and operational stages of CUNY's Gutman Community College. Dr. Jordan is currently the Dean of Social Sciences and Professional Studies at Greenfield Community College in Western Massachusetts. Welcome to EdCast, and thank you so much for joining us today.
Thanks, Linda. It's great to see you.
Good to see you too. You know, your book, as I said, is subtitled The Challenges, Successes, and Implications for Higher Education. And I'm thinking maybe that will serve as a good focus of our conversation today when we tell the Gutman Community College story. So I think, like any good story, maybe not any good story, but like lots of stories, let's start at the beginning, all right? So tell us how Gutman Community College began.
It's a really fascinating story, especially for those of us who live and love higher education. It's the Gutman idea was really started in earnest in 2007. And the planning went on for the next 5 years, but this notion of a new community college and the purpose behind it was started by former Chancellor Matthew Goldstein. And Matt's been a good friend over the years, and I've gotten a lot of the inside baseball information from him on what he was thinking and why he was thinking in 2007. So I'll set the context. As many probably know, CUNY's ASAP model has really expanded and exploded over the years. And the model provides block scheduling, some financial supports, and gives students an opportunity to move through the community college in a structured way. Prior to ASAP at CUNY, graduation rates were very low. Students had to piece together a schedule and then piece together work and life. And it often, those things were not congruent with one another. So with that and, zero credit remediation as well was another area where students were largely tracking into in the early part of the 2000s, there were some problems and the problems needed to be addressed. Many, many students were going to CUNY community colleges and many, many were not ever completing. So the Gutman idea was really born at the same time that ASAP was just getting off the ground and we had early data of the ASAP successes. Questions like, what if we bunched the class schedule together and allowed students to go in the morning and work in the afternoon? Would that make their schedules easier? What if we provided free Metro cards to students to be able to get to school so they didn't have to pay to get to school and make a decision between going to work and coming to class? What if we provided them with free textbooks? We all know that textbooks are extraordinarily expensive. So these were elements of the early ASAP model that were really starting to work. And graduation rates, at least in the early years, were starting to tick up significantly. When Matt Goldstein gave us the idea of the Gutman model, the idea was to build off of the ASAP model and create a whole new college with the structures of ASAP built into it. And the planning team was organized to do just that.
So ASAP was formed for accelerated student progress, to tell, to help them move along. And actually, we have done a show on ASAP if people are interested in going back and taking a look. So when Gutman is created, I know in your book, you make a point of that it had a very specific mission. However, you mentioned all the problems it wanted to address, but you also focus in on an overriding mission. And what was that overriding mission?
One mission: increase community college graduation rates substantially.
And so that is, you know, the actual focus, the raison d'etre, so to speak. So when the college is developed, it really seems to deviate from the traditional community college model in many ways. Can you tell us a little bit about the structure of the college, the ways in which it was different from what we've all come to know?
Absolutely. So the first piece that was an extraordinary change from what had come before was the absence of traditional developmental courses. Most colleges, community colleges, especially at the City University of New York, had developmental courses in math and in English. And at the time, about 75% of students entering into a community college needed some form of remediation, as we call it. Mm-hmm. Gutman abandoned that approach entirely. There had been years of data suggesting that the approach wasn't working. And the idea for Gutman was to totally shake things up. So instead of having zero credit remediation, the college was built with a very refined and specific curriculum. All students were going to start in the same place in a course called City Seminar, in a broader first year experience. Everyone would start earning college credit from the time that they started at the college. However, what was interesting was that the founders and the planners recognized that they believed that there needed to be developmental support built in. Mm-hmm. So why this looked different, the first year curriculum looked different, was that in order to earn 3 credits in the course City Seminar, students had to spend an enormous amount of time on task, 10 and a half hours a week in class to earn those 3 credits. And the idea was that the developmental skills were going to be embedded into the credit-bearing coursework. And this was revolutionary and quite radical at the time, particularly at the City University of New York. And then Gutman also had the elements of the ASAP model that we talked about a few moments ago, intrusive advising. The advisors were embedded with the faculty in what was called houses. Students were organized into cohorts, and the cohorts were organized into houses. Mm-hmm. So the faculty spent an enormous amount of time with advisors, meeting once a week in faculty advisor sessions and meeting with students regularly with the advisor to show that there was that marriage between student affairs, traditional, and academic affairs. The other things that were unique were that there was an emphasis on experiential learning and high impact practices. Gutman currently sits at 40th Street facing Bryant Park and was built with enormous amount of technology, laptop computers in every room, smart boards, and it was cutting edge at the time. Every student had an e-portfolio. Every student did experiential learning from the first year on. So there were elements that looked very different than a traditional experience.
There also, what struck me was there were no departments. And I'd like to go into that for a minute. And also the requirement also taken from ASAP that all students attend full time. So I'm going to ask you, as someone who's a member of a department, why were there no departments?
There's two stories to that. The first story is that the college was going to be small, and there weren't going to be enough students, at least in the first few years, for academic and enough faculty for enough academic departments to even exist. The kind of parallel rationale was that the college was meant to be interdisciplinary. Rather than having the silos of the disciplines, traditional math, traditional English, the curriculum was designed to be interdisciplinary. So it made more sense to the planners to have a faculty of the whole. That's one explanation. Mm-hmm. The other explanation is that if you got to know the planning team a bit, and the book talks quite a bit about who were a part of the planning team, John Mogilescu was university dean at the time and was leading the planning team for the development of Gutman Community College. And John had worked in the central office for most of his career and was not particularly fond of how slow he believed faculty made change to things like curriculum. So he saw the faculty as an obstacle and saw the college as something that needed to be nimble and responsive to its own data. And he saw the faculty and department chairs particularly as a barrier to that. So depends on which story you want to take, but both are probably true.
Oh, everybody sees the faculty as a barrier, except the faculty. However, Gutman learned the hard way that maybe it was a mistake to ignore the faculty. What happens with this overemphasis on experts, which I see the planning was really heavy on experts, which we all say is a good thing, this emphasis on experts and administrators rather than faculty? What may have been a shortcoming there for the future of the college, besides from the obvious maybe faculty buy-in, but in terms of the actual integrity of what a college should be doing?
There were a lot of missteps because of that decision. And you're absolutely right, Linda. The planning team was largely comprised of senior level administrators who did not work in community colleges, but also who relied on a body of research from national researchers in higher ed and community college reform who also didn't work in community colleges. Not saying that research was bad, it was very good, it was very informative, but it left out a key piece of knowledge, which was faculty in community colleges and their experience in educating students. Faculty understand complexity in a way that others who are not in the classroom with those students simply do not understand. So the planning team missed a key element of its planning, which was to include faculty in the process. There were passes at including faculty, there were surveys, there were focus groups, but when it really got down to the planning, there were very few in the way of faculty in the actual planning and design itself. The other misstep was that when the founding faculty were hired, they were all at the time untenured, brand new to their careers, assistant professors. So you hired a group of precarious faculty who were looking toward their own careers and protecting their own careers, and who didn't have the experience to challenge what eventually would become significant obstacles to the success of the Gutman model. And that lack of reliance on faculty expertise, particularly at the senior faculty level, created a gap in understanding, but also did not allow for the kinds of critical response to things that were evolving in the model that, you know, you and I would have been able to acknowledge later in our careers. That just, it wasn't possible with the kind of dynamics that existed early on.
So there are those two things that untenured faculty are loath to criticize. Their jobs are in jeopardy. And then say what one will, I honestly do believe that my many years of experience have made me better at what I do. And I think I have a far better understanding of curriculum and the challenges that students face than I did when I started out at Hostos Community College. So, I mean, you know, there is a certain amount of expertise that even the most obstinate faculty member somehow seems to acquire over the years. So I see. So let's go back then to what went right and what went wrong. Okay, so what does go right, it seems to me, is that there is a pretty good graduation rate at Gutman Community College. And so, you know, can't we say, voila, success? I mean, why do you feel so strongly that that is not the end of the story?
It is certainly not the end of the story, though it's part of the story. Early on, especially in the first couple of years, we were dealing primarily with about, the first class was about 280 students, and we added a few hundred more the next year. In comparison to place like where you're at, that's a very small fraction of the total student body. We recognized that we could do a lot of direct student support with a very small number of students, which I think very much contributed to the high graduation rates in the early years. So that's one perspective. The other perspective is that, and one that I address in the book, it's my view, based on data that we've gathered over the years and data that would come to us later, particularly looking at transfer data, that the curriculum was watered down. And I use those words very explicitly because when I was looking back through some of the archived minutes of University Faculty Senate meetings where the Gutman model was discussed far before its implementation, The response from the University Faculty Senate is that they looked at a curriculum that they believed would be watered down. And ultimately, our transfer data indicated that there indeed was a problem with the curriculum. Our students were not doing well after they transferred, and that problem was persistent over several years, and that was a concern. So the graduation rates, you know, I remember one study I did early on that when we first started getting transfer data that showed that our best students, our students with the highest GPAs at Guttman, were doing the worst once they transferred, which to me is an indication that there's something incredibly wrong with the curriculum. So I went back to that early warning from the University Faculty Senate and recognized that it had some validity. Mm-hmm. But if you look at the Guttman graduation rates over the past now 10 years, there has been a decline of 10 percentage points from the early years. So that level of strength in the graduation rates, if you want to look primarily at those numbers, has not held.
Now, you also, of course, levy a lot of criticism against the City Seminar, which, as you pointed out earlier, was a lot of time spent on task for a very few credit hours. But I must say, Chet, you go even further, and you really say that implicit in that model were some assumptions made about students that were negative. Do you want to go into that a little bit?
Sure. The first year curriculum, and I'm not shy about saying this, had a number of, and the model itself, the Guttman model itself, but particularly in the area of the first year curriculum, was incredibly racialized. In the concept paper, which was the formative document that laid out the blueprint for the development of Guttman Community College, in the opening statements, there is a key phrase that I've leaned on over the years as I've critiqued the institution and studied the institution. And it says that we recognize, and this is paraphrasing, but we, the planning team, recognize that all community college students and the ones who will eventually be enrolled at this new community college will require some form of remediation. And baked into that, from a kind of a critical race theory perspective or a deficit-minded perspective, you can very easily read the tea leaves. And it's saying, we recognize that since our students are primarily students of color, that we assume that they're not college ready. And it goes on to talk about who the student body will be. And if you make those connections, which it's not hard to do, you understand that there's a presumption going into the curriculum design itself. And for those of us who started to realize that there was a problem with the curriculum, you know, years later, as we started to look at our transfer data, we recognized very clearly that the first year curriculum, instead of abandoning the developmental model, the traditional remedial model, it scrambled it and applied the remedial designation, the stigma of remediation, to the entire student body.
So again, when I look back at this myself and I think of CUNY in 2012 or even 2007, when you say this thinking happened, I will say, maybe as devil's advocate or in defense, there really were big developmental concerns at that time. And there were many students entering our campuses who really were not able to do the kinds of writing and math that were expected of them. So I can have some sympathy for that view of, oh, they need extra help and we better bake it in here. But I see what you're saying, that they were not open to looking at the diversity in their own student body and seeing who required it and who might not require it. And that, yes, we have learned, of course, that to ask students to spend 10 and a half hours on task for something that's three credits or so, it seems to be a little unfair. I do want to ask you, you raise a number of other issues, of course, and also you focus, we don't have that much time, but if you could briefly tell us what you see as the assessment issues. And assessment, I think, is an issue for all of us. So what assessment at Guttman meant for Guttman and also for something we should all be aware of?
So this is a great question. If anyone who's watching is familiar with the background of the ASAP program. I'll again use that as an example.
Can you tell us what ASAP stands for, Chet?
Accelerated Study and Associate Programs. Yeah. ASAP has been successful largely due to its emphasis on assessment and evaluation. And I draw the comparison here because ASAP has constantly evaluated itself, both internally and has grown externally. Yeah. And those results have contributed to the shifts in how the program functions. And I think that that process and that component is essential to any new program and any institution, that we all have to be willing to make changes in response to our data. Guttman missed the mark on that. Even though it was an experimental institution and there was in the planning phase, a commitment to providing what was then called a Center for College Effectiveness, which was supposed to be the assessment arm of the college, which in name still exists, but more now more acts like a traditional office of institutional mm-hmm. research. We did miss the mark on that because there was no assessment of the model or evaluation of the model itself. And to date, still hasn't been. And it's been a huge misstep for the institution because it's not known how to respond to its own data.
I suppose assessment in general and education and business, there are certain assumptions we like to hang on to regardless of what we assess. I've been curious about this since I read the book, and that is, have you gotten any pushback from Guttman about the things you say in the book or from people at CUNY?
Absolutely. So
in their defense.
Yeah, it's I wrote my dissertation, my doctoral dissertation about Guttman. I compared Guttman to the ASAP model. Shortly after that, I started examining our transfer outcomes. I was part of a transfer grant that we received from the Mellon Foundation with former University Vice Chancellor Lex Logue. She was my research partner, and Colin Chelman in the Office of Institutional Research. But I started focusing on Guttman's almost squarely and evaluating our transfer outcomes. And as I started presenting those, I got enormous pushback from the faculty. I gave a book talk about this last week, and some of those faculty were there and providing some consistent but very pointed critique of my argument. Primarily, the feedback has been, and this is pretty typical, that the data represented don't represent the entire picture, and that we need a larger sample size. The data were selected from a small group of people. The argument back to that, and the argument that I have to the faculty at Guttman who think that this critique is incorrect, is that we were lucky to have a very small sample size. I could look at the whole student body at one time. And though we couldn't do any sort of predictive analysis, we were looking at real data. We were looking at 45 people who transferred and did not do well. We weren't looking at a sample. We were looking at the whole transfer population. And that was telling. And the last thing I'll say to the critiques is that the way the Guttman model is organized right now benefits faculty enormously. It provides them with a great deal of reassigned time to teach in the first year experience. So there's an unwillingness, as you might imagine, to make a change that would reduce one's own compensation for teaching in the model the way it's currently constructed.
So we are running out of time, as always happens to us. So quickly, if you could, tell me, what do you think is the biggest takeaway for people who want to undertake this kind of educational reform?
The biggest takeaway is that it's so necessary to understand local context. I believe firmly that if faculty who had taught in community colleges like yourself for a long time had been part of the planning process, we would have at least in part understood that the model, the way it was configured, would not have provided the kind of impact and in turn may have been harmful to students over the long run. But without that perspective, the model and the planning went on without understanding that. And that was a huge negative impact in the long run.
So if we're undertaking reform, know where we're coming from and who we are working with. This is a really interesting story, Chet, and I thank you so much for joining us today. I really recommend the book. I think it's really has a lot to say. So Thank you so much for joining us today, Chet Jordan, author of Establishing an Experimental Community College in the United States. It's been a pleasure seeing you again.
Likewise to you. Thank you so much.
And don't go away. We'll be right back with our Ed Bites. Welcome back to this edition of Ed Bites. Do you know about the IKEA Fracta bag? If you do, you might have recently packed up someone for college. A recent Vox article, College Dorm Shopping Industrial Complex is Real, reports that $26.7 billion will be spent on back-to-school purchases. This includes dorm items such as bedding, furniture, and appliances. There are even consulting firms to help students achieve the well-designed dorm room. The Vox article points out that the college years are ones of separation and psychological growth. Dorm decor may be one way students can showcase their independence and identity. To praise or scold is often the question. What is the best approach to improving student behaviors? Middleweb Smart Brief reports that a recent study from Brigham Young University found that middle school students respond more to praise than to criticism. Teachers who praise desired behaviors at least as much as reprimanding undesirable ones improved overall class conduct by up to 70%. Parents, take note. As the return to school gets underway, we've heard about the concerns of parents and educators. At the top of the list have been learning loss, getting back to normal, and boosting low test scores. EdSurge reports that a survey of 4,000 students and 200 teachers indicate that these might be media-hyped concerns, but not the ones of those on the ground. Their biggest concerns instead were rundown school facilities and an overstuffed curriculum that doesn't provide opportunities for personal connection and exploring student areas of interest. Higher Ed Dive reports on the sharp decline in the submission of ACT and SAT scores by college applicants for the academic year 2020-21. Only about two-fifths included their scores, down from three-quarters the previous year. Research by Common App indicated that first-generation and minority students were less likely to provide exam scores than other peers. Test optional policies might help colleges attract more applicants from these underrepresented groups. That's it for this edition of EdCast. Thanks so much for joining us. See you next time.
We'd like to hear from you. Please send your thoughts and comments to cuneedcast@gmail.com.